Dr. Ambedkar, when he spoke about the pillars of India's constitution, we talk about liberty, we talk of freedom, and we talk about equality. But what we often forget about is that the third pillar of India's constitution is fraternity. And I like the Hindi translation, which is bandhuta, which I think explains most clearly what the idea of fraternity is. It is the idea that we belong to each other. And what has happened to that idea over the last 1 year is what I will request my two very, very eminent and fine thinking intellectual of the country. The word secularism is contested. Ashish quite famously has questioned the term. You can call it secularism, you can call the idea anything else. But the idea in India of equal respect for every faith, including the absence of faith, which is a more ancient idea, translating in the context of the modern republic to the guarantee of equal rights and equal protection of people regardless of their faith. In a secular democracy, each of us are entitled to our personal moralities, to our religious and community moralities. But what we agree to is to subordinate those moralities to the higher morality of the constitution. So that is another way of perhaps expressing the idea of secular democracy. The constitution was extremely anxious to lay down also the rights of minorities, especially religious minorities. The first of those rights, which have been very carefully guarded in our constitution, has been their right to not just practice, but also to propagate their faith. And that has become an extremely contested idea with the movements over the last year around against conversions, seeing conversions as a somewhat anti-national idea, and also the notion of ghar vapsi, which seems to suggest that one faith is the actual home, and if people move away from that faith, it is in some way a moving away. It's a sort of the prodigal son or daughter moving away. And that idea, I think there's also within this notion an idea of the guarantee of security and safety, and which brings us really to questions of whether people were safe living and being who they are in terms of their religious and cultural identities. We perhaps have moved away, perhaps permanently, after 2002 and its aftermath, from mega, huge, visible massacres, communal massacres, to low intensity but very widespread communal mobilization. And what has been the experience of this during this past year? And finally, I think the idea of secular democracy for me includes a guarantee of equal opportunities of all. And so these are the very range of yardsticks against which in this session, I will request first Neera and then Ashish to evaluate what has happened over the last 1 year and where do they see India's movement in relation to the constitutional guarantee of fraternity.
Thank you. Well, I have to congratulate the organizers of this conclave for propelling the idea of India into the front forefront of debate. The domain of politics in India has shrunk so dramatically in the last 1 year that along with the shrinking, we see a shrinking of the idea of India. Now the Indian population seems to rest its hopes upon one man who will come riding a white horse in a shining armor and rescue the maiden from the dragon. Whenever you hear the Prime Minister talking about democracy, he talks about governance. It's actually very amusing on Christmas Day, which they had declared as Good Governance Day. It seems to me the cadres of Hindutva are particularly joyless. They have no idea of how to celebrate life. Drink a cup of wine, eat a cup, slice of cake, say Merry Christmas, peace be on everyone. And it struck me, why are they sending me an SMS? Governance is a property of the government. I don't do practice good governance. The government does. But more alarmingly, the idea of governance does not encapsulate the idea of democracy as the politics of affirmation and contestation at all. It's interesting. We get all these SMSs by ministers, by various ministries, Pradhan Mantri ki, what is it called, Man Ki Baat, this, that. You cannot write back to the government. You cannot return an SMS. You cannot say, guys, why are you wishing me good governance day? Wish me Merry Christmas. This whole notion of governance is a very different debate, but it is an alarmingly management-oriented view of politics. It's not a view of politics. And if you look at the government, the way it's behaving, its assault on civil society organizations, this casting of civil society is into doubt. In October 19, 2014, at the Geneva Human Rights Commission meeting on granting of space for civil society organizations, the Indian government voted along with Bahrain, which is known for jailing dissidents, against the idea of giving space to civil society organizations on the plea that their funding is suspect and they have no accountability. You know, somebody who has been dealing with civil society and kind of critiquing it, suddenly we find ourselves, you know, it is important to have civil society. You look at all these insurance policies, at all the various policies that the government is enunciating. It's interesting, in the UPA, these policies followed civil society mobilization and Supreme Court intervention. But this is the kind of social policy that has been very symptomatic of East Asian states, where authoritarian, benevolent despots give you social policy, but in the Indian case, of course, there's neither a timeline nor funding. States will do it, given them enough time. But there is complete skepticism about civil society. So the notion of democracy as majority rule is really truncated the idea of democracy and the idea of India. And the second way this has really is problematic, because I think the present leadership, I'm confident, I think most of us are confident, the present leadership has absolutely no idea about the complexity of India. The preconditions of democratic theory is that every individual is capable of conceiving and formulating their projects, their notions of the good, and they should be left alone as far as possible to do so. The object of the state is to create conditions where they can realize agency, when they can speak back to power, when they can speak back to history. Today we have a situation where we are being told what to eat and what not to eat, what to wear, what not to wear. We have crazy, you know, enunciations coming from peculiarly illiterate leaders saying women shouldn't wear this, women should, who to marry, who not to marry. Yes, how to live, how not to live, what religion to follow, what not religion to follow. Today, the most complex issue in the history of the world is how people in a society who subscribe to different ideas of the good, who speak different languages, who worship different gods, can live together, if not in harmony, at least in civility. And perhaps the notion of secularism has been unable to achieve this. And I'm saying this with great regret. You know, France in 1905 very gleefully proclaimed the independence of politics from religion, from the church. Today, France tries to proclaim the independence of politics from Islam, notwithstanding its colonial past, because Mahmoud Mamdani asked in a piece, he said the Algerians are in France because France was in Algeria and they ruined Algeria. Europe is not looking at its colonial past, and Europe is not looking at recognizing the contribution these immigrants have made to their economy. Immigration was in the context of major unemployment in the whole of Europe after the Second World War. So in a manner of speaking, rather than recognizing the giving to respect to other religions and to other ways of being, the French government has actually made secularism an extremely totalitarian, authoritarian concept, which denies access to even citizens who are children of immigrants to the public sphere. You cannot enter the public sphere if you're wearing a headscarf, right? You cannot, in very many, many schools, and now, you know, you have the amazing thing, everybody has to, I won't even go about it because I'm so agitated. The point is, we have to understand that secularism as A precondition of democracy today is no longer harnessed to the democratic project because it is no longer harnessed to the idea of equality. And I would suggest that all these pronunciations that are coming to us from the various illiterate aspects of the Hindutva Brigade are meant to terrify minorities into not participating in the rich deliberation and democratic negotiation on what it means to be an Indian, what is India, what is the idea of India. This fear of inhibition is truly shocking. You know, Raymond Williams used to say, I never read the morning newspaper, it destroys my day. I cannot write a word. And the same thing is happening every this morning. They are completely blackening any signboard which has a Muslim name. I mean, these are the various gestures toward talking of democracy not as a domain of contestation in which everybody should get voice, but as majority rule. And majority rule is a peculiarly illiterate way of conceiving democracy. Nobody beyond the sixth standard should believe that majority rule is good democracy. We have to de-link, as in orthodox literature, the link between secularization and secularism, and that's precisely what has gone wrong in France. The assumption that people are not religious is a precondition for separating the state from religion. We have to talk of secularism in a religious society. That we are religious is beyond doubt. Political secularism in a religious society, and that project of secularism has to be harnessed to two essential notions. Then I'll make a very strong comment here. I do not think secularism is a stand-alone concept. I mean, there was a time in India in the early part of the 21st century when every leader would say we are secular, but they were not democratic. Secularism is not an apogee for democracy or a stand-in for democracy. Secularism is a part of the democratic project because it emerges from the two principles of democracy, equality and freedom. And the idea of the state being respecting equality and freedom. So secularism should be very much a part of the democratic project. We cannot dislocate it and steep it as this. It belongs to a family, and the first family is democracy. The second family is an idea called toleration. And I'll briefly speak about it. In political theory, we don't speak of tolerance, it's toleration, but very briefly, what is toleration in the Indian context? In the 1920s, Gandhi starts to organize a mass movement of people who would not speak to each other, who would not talk with each other, who would not dine with each other, let alone marry their children to each other. And he creates the principle, all paths are equal. All paths to the truth are equal. Now, this is a very important concept of Advaita. But more importantly, Gandhi, who incidentally translates into Gujarati Plato's Apology, which is about the trial of Socrates, talks about an epistemological deficit. Very quickly, Socrates is tried by an Athenian jury for having corrupted the youth, and they asked him, why do you go around talking to people? And he said, see, I have a problem. A friend of mine went to the oracle at Delphi, and the oracle told him that the wisest man in Athens is Socrates. And Socrates said, I knew that was a lie. I'm not the wisest man in Athens. Then I wanted to disprove the oracle. So I went around talking to various wise men, poets and philosophers and various other people. And I found, actually, I'm wiser than they. They don't even know they don't know. At least I know I don't know. And Gandhi said exactly the same thing. You don't know that you know. Truth is so elusive. Right? If you don't know and nobody else knows, then all of you have to join together in a shared search for the truth. You will never find it. Truth is not something you can find. You can only search for it. It has to be a combined effort. More importantly, if you don't know and you don't know better than the other person, you cannot afford to be violent or superior to them. Violence arises out of confidence. I know better than the other. So I conclude by saying it is time to rework the concept of secularism, to place it in the democratic project, to see it as an intrinsic part of democracy, and also see it as a link with toleration. Thank you.
Ashish is always interesting and provocative, and he, on principle, says he doesn't prepare before he comes to speak.
But I won't enter into a debate. Mm. I'm no debater. If you look at the entire 20th century, we have killed roughly 225 million, 22.5 crores of people during the century in mass violence or genocides. If you look at the data carefully, go into the contents of the data, look at the situations, which you can easily do, lot of conclusions can be drawn. I will draw your attention to a few of them. First of all, the data show that 2/3 of the people killed in genocide in 20th century were killed by their own states. Your own state can be dangerous for your health. Two, if you look at the data in from another point of view, 2/3 of the people were killed by secular states. Secular states may be very good for India, but it has not been very good for the health of human beings over the last 100 years. And three, this data also seems to suggest that a majority of people killed were killed in genocides which took place, in fact, it will put it another way, the goriest and the worst genocides, let's put me that way, were not between strangers, people you did not know, but between communities which were very close to one another. A French anthropologist, a Belgian anthropologist, when the country was Belgian Congo, was once requested to do a profile of who is a Tutsi and who is a Hutu. After hard work, he came to the conclusion that these two communities cannot be distinguished ethnographically. The only ready way of distinguishing them is this, that those who have more than 5 heads of cattle are Hutus, and those who have less than 5 heads are Tutsis. And yet, these people, Hutus managed to kill, mainly Hutus, managed to kill 1 million people, 10 lakhs of people in 10 days, nearly 1 million, a little less than 1 million, in 10 less than 10 days. I might also point out that during the partition violence, the goriest violence took place in Punjab, where the three communities, Muslims, Sikhs and Hindus, were very closely intertwined. It is in this context we have to decide on the fate of secularism and its relationship with democracy. I do believe that secularism in a society like this is not only useless, but dishonest and hierarchizing. Even Mr. Narendra Modi is trying very hard to prove that he is a secular person, that the genuine variety of secularism. As a person who has been sued for fomenting communal violence by Mr. Modi and his hatchet man Amit Shah, let me not go into the details of the record of secularism in great details. We all know that secularism, alias laicite, came to France after the Protestant had been evicted very successfully from France. And mind you, Protestants were not that different from the Catholics. So Protestants now, French Protestants are now mostly in Switzerland making watches for us, which we all wear probably to show our allegiance to French version and respect for French version of secularism. When recently Switzerland decided not to allow the only community which voted against it were the French Protestants settled in Switzerland. Only 4 cantons voted for it, voted against it. So that is the record. And I would suggest to you that I have become, in any case, very hostile to the idea of ideology itself. Because I notice that if you look at it very carefully, the genocide data of 20th century also shows that ideology also is a very good killer. Ideology, I would also include nationalism in its various forms. So I have very little faith in nationalism. I am an admirer of Dr. Johnson, who said nationalism is the last refuge of the scoundrels. 250 years ago. So that's a long time for that saying to survive, and I do confirm to that. Where do we go from here? I have no objections to our constitution. It was quite secular even before Mrs. Gandhi introduced the term secularism, and nobody dared to take it out from there. First of all, I believe that all the people we venerate as symbols of cultural diversity, religious diversity, diversity of faith, themselves did without the term secularism, except for one, which is Jawaharlal Nehru. All the rest had never heard of secularism, from Ashoka to Kabir. I'm afraid that has something to say to us, that if you had probably, somebody had spent, if not half a life, but at least one-tenth of his life or her life, to find out what are the categories they used for their faith, maybe we could have reached somewhere. In the remaining 3 minutes, I am sure there is still 3 minutes left, let me tell you two stories to say what I want to say. On the 50th anniversary of India's independence, we found out that an old friend of mine also was collecting data on partition to concentrate only on one kind of events, where somebody from another community has saved a person from death. And he told me, we included in our work, he told me that he got inspiration to do this work because he was visiting a family friend. He is a Pakistani, Ahmed Salim, and he was visiting a friend of his. And somebody, hearing that he was trying to do this study, told him that the head of the family, a woman whose husband was dead, eldest brother of the householder, was an abducted woman. She was abducted by a young Sikh who came in a gang, and they abducted a lot of Muslim women. And she said that when the young Sikh took her to his home, his father was upset. He said, "Son, this is not allowed in our religion. Please go and return this woman to her family." The boy did not. So the father picked up his sword and killed his son, and himself went with the abducted woman and returned her to the family. This is one way one can look at it, that what motivates them, what category, what ideas, what I am sure that old Sikh has something to offer us. I am telling this story that the seeds of what we need, the resistance to violence, the resistance to bitterness and hatred, can come only from the ordinary people living their ordinary lives in very ordinary ways. And I do believe that future lies there.
Thank you, Ashish. Precisely what has happening to that ground reality that Ashish speaks about, endorsing, you know, I am not prepared to give up the word secularism to describe it, but that's a minor intellectual quibble. But the idea that we belong to each other, having spent more than 10 years now working on the ground in Gujarat, there's one thing that I can sort of, you know, you hear all the stories of cruelty, of extreme cruelty during 2002. But today I can say that for every story of cruelty in every village where it has occurred, I will find you 3 stories of people saving lives. It is equally our reality, and it is that secular fraternal idea that I think is so deeply in assault. because we are trying to draw up a report card of the last 1 year, I think it's important to say what has happened to the idea of not the denial of faith, but equal respect for every faith as a traditional civilizational idea in this country. We spoke about France. In France, the secular idea would be to not allow a woman to come into a gathering like this with a hijab. In India, it would be to defend her right to wear that hijab. And so we must recognize that it is a profound, distinct idea which has to be held on. And very importantly, what is secular practice by government not? We need to look at what Mamata Banerjee, for instance, is doing in her appeasement of the worst fundamentalist kind of mullahs. We have to also see what Mulayam Singh is doing. And here I'll just give you one example which I just find extraordinary. One thing that we found riot after riot is that what happens is that one of the things that happens is in every relief camp after a major riot, there's large-scale marriages that take place. And this is a peculiar phenomenon that we found now, right from Bhagalpur to Gujarat, to Muzaffarnagar, we found that this has happened repeatedly because of some sad idea that a young Muslim woman who has lived through a major riot stands under the taint, the social taint that she might have been sexually molested, and therefore it's important to get her married as quickly as possible. And we found that the marriages that took place in Gujarat, almost all of them ended up in divorce and in very severe domestic violence. But Mulayam Singh's government actually passed a scheme to pay 1 lakh rupees for every marriage that takes place in the camp. And these are underage child marriages. I mean, it's one of the most bankrupt ideas because he was being advised by the most fundamentalist mullahs, and he thought that is secularism. And so I think that we need to understand what we are talking about as secular practice and what we are not. Just talking about the last 1 year, I'd like to say a few things that worry me deeply. I feel that spectacular, large communal massacres of the kind that we saw in Gujarat may hopefully have passed into history because of the kind of resistance using democratic instruments for which Mr. Modi himself had to face a great deal of international opprobrium and so on. But that is not, it's not given away to communal peace. It's given way to a strategy of low intensity, small local attacks all over the country. And we've done a record of those. And it's frightening, the numbers and the kind of sense of fear that has got created with attacks both on Muslims and Christians. Also, you know, that idea that I had spoken about earlier about the constitutional morality being superior to individual and personal moralities, the whole notions of ghar vapsi and so on. But 2 days ago, something that might sound irrelevant, but the government announced an extraordinary decision after, you know, decades of struggle to where child labor was banned, all child labor at least up to the age of 14, because of a child is meant to be in school, how can the child be at work? And what this government has said, no, we are going to allow, legalize children working with their families because we don't want to interfere with the social economic fabric. In simple words, it means we want to revive the idea of caste because they say, I mean, you know, in fact, I was arguing with the labor secretary and he was saying, but what's wrong? I mean, a lohar son has to learn to be a lohar. A weaver son has to learn to be a weaver. Why should a lohar son have to learn to be a lohar? Why can't he learn to be a poet? Why can't a weaver's daughter learn to be a nuclear scientist? Why can't my daughter learn to be a weaver if that is what her aptitude is? And I think that this idea again of bringing back a very unequal cultural ethos to me is deeply anti-secular. The debate around conversions has been revived again and again. And we must remember that our constitution guaranteed the right of every person not just to practice their faith, but also to propagate it. And the idea that encouraging somebody to follow a faith different from the Hindu faith is somehow anti-national. Brings me to Gandhiji's reminder when he was asked, shouldn't only Indian religions be allowed to be fostered in our country? He said, yes, I totally agree. Indian religions like Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, Sikhism and so on. These are all Indian religions. I worry also about, evidence of what I would call the communal application of the judicial mind. When we see bail for a person like Maya Kodnani, we see bail for a whole set of Babu Bajrangi now. Police officers charged with encounter killings. And on the other hand, we see the fate of honest police officers like Rahul Sharma, who stood up for justice and the rule of law. I wanted to, again, draw your attention to the consequences of the attacks and the assault on the secular idea of India that we see over the last year in particular and its build-up by what has happened in Muzaffarnagar. In Muzaffarnagar, the populations, what happened was that traditionally we had Jat landlords for whom Muslim landless workers worked. We had Muslim landlords for whom Dalit Hindu workers worked. And this is something that has happened, and very peacefully, they've never had riots in 47, they've not had riots in even in the Babri Masjid period. What happened now is that after the violence of 2012, the Muslim landless workers who used to work for Hindu Jats and Gujars ran away to Muslim majority, those villages where Muslim landlords were there. And so now they have started working for Muslim landlords. The Hindu Dalit landless workers have started working for Hindu Gujar and Jat landlords. And I find that a profound, it's something that makes you profoundly sad, because this kind of separation of populations is what is the long-term accomplishment of massacres of the kind that we saw in Muzaffarnagar. And then I went back to Bhagalpur, the other major rural riot that we have seen. I found that exactly the same thing has happened. Populations, now Muslims have started living only with Muslims. Hindus have only started living with Hindus. The same thing has happened in Gujarat. Therefore, what we are seeing is a separation of populations, that we have to live separately and as second-class citizens if we are religious minorities. So those are the kinds of worries that we see among us. Mahatma Gandhi used to talk about Hindus and Muslims as being his two eyes. So really he was talking about Hindu-Muslim unity. As he went along his life, he reached a stage when he said, okay, if not unity, then maybe amity. Towards the end of his life, he said, okay, if not even amity, can there be at least coexistence? And we are reaching a stage today when we are saying we're not even willing to live with each other. I think it's a crisis to which each of us need to respond. Thank you.